Happy Burnsday, everyone. I'm pleased that the next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 3351 in the name of Emma Harper on celebrating Burns and the Scots language. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now. I call on Emma Harper to open the debate. There are a lot of subscribers to this debate, so please be quiet during your time. 7 minutes, please, Ms Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today is Robert Burns' birthday, the ideal day to celebrate Robert Burns and the Scots language. 220 years after his death, I declare an interest as President of Dumfries Ladies Burns Club No. 1. Folk fia our the world and here in Scotland celebrate Burns on this day. Whether they're in the Globe Inn in Dumfries with the Howth Club or in the place of the Bard's Birth in Alloway. There's much clatter and singing the songs and reciting the verses written by the best known Scottish bard. Burns' mother tongue was Scots. He spoke and wrote the Scots language. He speared and screeved the Scots lead. My mother tongue was Scots when I was a wee lassie. Then, as I grew up, I lost a lot because it wasn't acceptable to use the Scots words at school. I'm rediscovering the money words that I used as a wean that weren't used in school when I grew up on the farm with the other weans. We were happy to get clarty when we louped the burns, duked awa for the kicking kai in the byre, managing to hang on to our jammy pieces when we were clapped in our wally knees. I'm saddened. It garts me greet that 40 years after being telt, don't speak like that, speak properly. I am now learning my lost lead again. Robert Burns was asked to avoid his Scots and submit for the Kilmarnock edition poems in English. And further correspondence to his publisher, George Thompson, when he was requested to write supplementary poems in English, Burns wrote, "If you're for English verses, there is, on my part, an end of the matter. I have not that command of the language that I have of my native tongue. In fact, I think my ideas are more barren in English than in Scottish." The Kilmarnock edition was printed in Scots. It did much to support, popularise and champion the Scots lead. And I would argue that we are richer for this decision. My motion states that Robert Burns influenced thinkers around the world. Abraham Lincoln, Che Guevara and Hugh McDermott. Even Bob Dylan said Robert Burns was his greatest inspiration. This year, the influence of Burns on the USA is marked in a special TV documentary on the BBC, which I'm guy looking for it to watching. Burns wrote about fairness and equality in many of his songs, and there's one song, "A Man's a Man for A' That," that when Midgeyear sang it at the opening of this session, it showed how powerful and relevant the words are the day. "Ye see yon birkie ca'd a lord, wha struts aboot and a' that, though honours worship at his word, he's but a coof for a' that. For a' that and a' that, his ribbon star and a' that. The man o' independent mind, he looks and laughs at a' that." Scottish Parliament recognises Robert Burns, and many after him should be celebrated for screeving and spearing in their ain lead. Burns' words have such muckle stanning as they have been embedded on the outside of the walls of this very building. Jackie Kay, the Scots Macker, she's got a wee Scots poem for the baby box. And Billy Kay was last year awarded service to the Scots for his commitment to advancing the lead for many years. The cultural significance of the Scots language has been promoted by the Scottish Government. Much progress has been made to advance the knowledge and understanding of the cultural importance or recognise the Scots lead in recent years. Minister Alistair Allen must be commended. We now have the Scots Language Centre, the National Library of Scotland, the Wee Windies, and great Scots language resources for teachers. There's been great work done by many scientists, neurolinguisticists, sick as Dr. Michael Dempster, an exceptional champion of the Scots lead, Matthew Fitt. Both are here the day in the gallery. Matthew Fitt is teaching Wanes in some of the most deprived areas. He told me the other day, Scots is the silver bullet for raising the confidence of so many of Scotland's Wanes who have been told they aren't clever simply because they speak Scots. I'm just starting to understand the implications for the Wanes and how not only allowing but expecting that better attainment, there's that word again, can be achieved by focusing more on our native tongue. And then there's the neuro-linguistical research conducted by Michael Dempster. He's exploring developmental language in the brain and how learning the Scots at an early age, even at the same time as English, is key to understanding our functional development. He's calling for Scots to be a central consideration in all speech research carried out in Scotland. Watch him on YouTube. We're needing to talk about our language. Worldwide evidence suggests bilingual people have many cognitive advantages, including later onset of dementia by around 5 years. This suggests the use of Scots is a potential untapped goldmine in care and wellbeing work in Scotland. Presiding officer, all of the websites, videos, education materials and the experts I have spoken to promote furthering Scots language and bringing the benefits to us all. We need to mark sticker that the lead guns for it. I'm asking the Scottish Government to continue to support the lead and celebrate Burns for keeping our language alive, and let's continue to transmit it orally, but perhaps even more important, scriving it, recording it, getting it written down. This is crucial. Finally, Presiding Officer, I commend my motion, Burns in the Scots language, to your sonsy face.
Well, talking of sonsy faces, I call John Scott to be followed by Willie Coffey.
Presiding Officer, when Chapman Billies leave the street and Ruthie Neighbours and Neighbours meet, as market days are wearing late and folk begin to tack the gate, and we sit boozing at the nappy, getting foo and unca happy, we think none the long Scots miles, the mosses, water slaps and stiles that lie atween us in our hame, where sits our sulky sullen dame, gathering our brews like gathering storm, nursing our wrath to keep it warm. This truth, fund honest Tam O'Shanter, as he fi air, ae naich did canter, all day, where ne'er a tune surpasses, for honest men and bonny lasses. And, Presiding Officer, I will stop there, before you all become too enthralled in this magnificent poem which defines Burns, Ayrshire and Broad Scots. And at this point, can I agree with Emma Harper that one of Burns' great achievements was to help firmly establish Scots, or indeed Broad Scots, as a language in its own right. The reason for this is that Tam O'Shanter is an epic poem, on a par with Milton's Paradise Lost, and recognised worldwide as being so. Another reason for reciting these lines is to show that in addition to this still being the living language of many Lowland Scots to this day, the observations in his works are as relevant to this day as they were then. Gathering her brews like gathering storm, nursing her wrath to keep it warm, is still the welcome on many a doorstep to many men in Ayrshire at any rate, following enjoyment at a hostelry of their choice and a forewarning of a row to come. And the lines, "O would some poor the gift to gie us the poor to see ourselves as others see us, it would for money a blunner free us, and foolish notion," was and remains a shorthand for mockery and condemnation of vanity and stupidity in daily and indeed political life. And there are many more quotations from Burns that have become part of many people's life and language, my own included, coming from a farming background like Emma. Burns, though, was unique, which is why his words have been translated into so many different languages. The Russians put aside Tolstoy, the French put aside Voltaire, to read and recognise the quality of his work, and over 10,000 Burns suppers are held annually at this time of year to celebrate the range of his work. These suppers bring people together to discuss, debate and appreciate and enjoy the value and the meaning of his work, whether that be an analysis of his poetry, his songs or his letters. because his own life was so convivial. His legacy has engendered spirited gatherings and suppers where fun and laughter predominate with philosophical discourse on offer too. Indeed, tonight, here in our own Parliament building, our presiding officer is, as we speak, welcoming guests from all over the world, as well as parliamentarians, to the presiding officer's burnt supper, now well established as one of the highlights of our parliamentary year. However, what set Burns apart was not his observations of human nature, nor his wit, or his satire, or his views of the church, or his ambivalent political views, but it was his empathy that made him so special. His unique ability to connect with and relate and appeal to all levels of society, whether in his own time in Edinburgh or his beloved Ayrshire, and to still be relevant and connected to this day, is what sets him apart from others. His ability to take the ordinary day-to-day aspects of life and love and comment in verse or song on them makes him and his legacy unique. And so tonight, Presiding Officer, we celebrate this legacy that has established Ayrshire, his birthplace, and the Robert Burns Birthplace Museum as a must-visit location for the worldwide Scottish diaspora and others who are rightly so proud of him and who flock to Ayrshire, to Alloway, to Burns Cottage, to the banks of the Doon, to see for themselves the landscape and buildings which inspired Tam O'Shanter and many other works. Thank you.
I call Willie Coffey to be followed by Lewis MacDonald.
Presiding Officer, thank you and congratulations to Emma Harper for securing this members' debate celebrating Burns in the Scots language. There was indeed a blast of January when, on or shortly after the night Burns was born in 1759, a portion of the old clay biggin in Alloway built by his father William was said to have blown in during a storm, a fitting entrance to this world perhaps for Scotland's greatest poet, and that same blast of wind still blows as strongly today as it did then. We are eternally grateful to Robert Burns for what he did, not just for the magnificent poetic legacy that he left us during his 37 short years, but by writing in his native Scots Ayrshire tongue, he gave credibility to the Scots language and probably set the foundations for its recognition internationally. Aren't we relieved that Burns basically ignored the pleas by Dr. John Moore and others in 1787, just a year after the Kilmarnock edition was published, to write, not in Scots, but in English, to reach, as he put it, a wider audience of admirers. He did attempt some work in standard English, but quickly abandoned it. His book was already a huge success, and he was working on his Edinburgh edition, and lots of his works in Scots had already been penned, awaiting publication. So thank God for that and the legacy we now enjoy, written in that rich Scots language of Ayrshire, where much of it can still be heard today. Can you recall, Presiding Officer, the small but famous extract from Tam O'Shanter that was initially led by my colleague John Scott? O Tam, hadst thou been so wise as ta'en thy ain wife Kate's advice? She tell ye, well, there was a skellum, a blethering, blustering, drunken blellum, that fae November till October, e market day, thou was nae sober. And the unthinkable version of it in English. Oh, Thomas, had you but been so wise as to have taken your own wife Kate's advice, she told you well you were a waster, a rambling, blustering, drunken boaster, that from November until October each market day you were not sober. It's much, much more than the Scots words themselves that are lost there. The equivalent words are there, but for me, there's no real connection with the sense of drama and devilment, and as a result, the impact of such a wonderful depiction that scene illustrates would have been diminished beyond repair. Interestingly, most if not all of his letters were written in highly polished technical English, even more elaborate than we see today, reflecting the style of the 18th century. But when it came to exercising his creative talents in poetry, or shaping and crafting the lyrics of many hundreds of Scots folk songs that would have been lost had he not intervened, Burns was clearly at home using the everyday language of his own people, and I think he knew that. We have other more contemporary Scots writers to thank too for keeping our language fresh and current. McDermott, of course, wrote masterpieces like The Drunk Man Looks at the Thistle in Scots, and even has a conversation with Burns in it, saying, Rabbi, wouldst thou were here, the world hath need thee, and Scotland mercy, o the likes of thee, that whisky wan smoothed your lyres become a laxative for all loquacity. A plea, I think, for more intelligent and informed discourse amongst the people, especially when talking about Burns himself. And back to Ayrshire again briefly, we are proud of our other two sons, Billy Kay for Gosden and Rab Wilson for New Cumnock. Billy making a huge contribution to the Scots language in his book The Mother Tongue and his numerous radio and TV productions, all delighting in using Scots as his preferred medium. And Rab Wilson, distinguished writer and poet who wrote a magnificent poem for us in Scots in 2009 during the dispute with Diageo over the ridiculous decision to take Johnny Walker away from Kilmarnock after 189 years. Presiding Officer, our Scots language is very much alive today, but it could always benefit more from use, more exposure and more encouragement, especially amongst our youngsters, to create new works, poems and songs in their native language. We too have a role to play as MSPs in the Scottish Parliament. We too should use our own language much more than we probably do. After all, it's who we are and we shouldn't be feared to use it. Well done to Emma Harper for bringing this matter to the attention of the Parliament. Thank you.
Lewis MacDonald, to be followed by Ruth Maguire.
Thank you. I am sorry I have to leave before the Minister's reply, Presiding Officer, for which my apologies to all concerned. But I am very grateful to Emma Harper for bringing this debate, in part because of my father, the Reverend Roderick MacDonald. He was first a published poet in Gaelic, Scotland's other language too long neglected, and an enthusiastic translator between English and Gaelic. He was deeply honoured to be crowned Bard of the National Mod in 1977. But when he went from St Columba's Parish Church in Stornoway to Inch Parish Church in Aberdeenshire, he discovered a third Scottish tongue for poetry and prose, just as we, his children, discovered it in daily life. Aberdeenshire Scots is known today as Doric, thanks to the classical preoccupations of 19th century scholars. But it is in truth one of the richest regional varieties of a language which is to be heard in many places from Shetland to Galloway. That Lowland Scots is not heard in the Outer Hebrides, but it is still the mother tongue of local children in Inch, in the Geary, and in many other communities besides. And Roddy MacDonald would have fully agreed with the view expressed in the motion this evening that the written word in a standard form is vitally important to sustaining and transmitting a living but largely oral culture from one generation to the next. He considered himself bilingual, which he defined as not just speaking and writing in two languages, not even just thinking in two languages, but dreaming in both Gaelic and English, as he had done for most of his life. I don't think he ever dreamt in Scots, but he did make understanding and explaining the relationships among Scots and English and Gaelic a real focus of his learning and his creativity in the second half of his life. There is a book which reflects that focus very well, which he wrote in collaboration with Joyce Colley and Derek McClure in 1995. It goes not by one name, but by three. It is called Trilingual Poetry, Bardach Chichananach, and also Sangs in Three Tongues. And that was original and groundbreaking, but it was in translating the entire works of Robert Burns from Scots and English into Gaelic that Roddy MacDonald's scholarship in Scots and creativity in Gaelic found their perfect fusion. As Derek McClure has since said, what is impressive about the work is not just that it is its scale, but also that the translations succeed in retaining the metre and rhythms in which Burns wrote while presenting them in a quite different language. But my father would have said that achieving that was not so hard or down only to his own poetic gifts. He was delighted to discover that a good deal of the Scots language of Robert Burns derived from the Gaelic language, which some earlier translators had indeed failed to recognise. The Scots tongue of Robert Burns is not, as some would have it, different from Northern English because only of loan words from Scandinavia or the Low Countries or France. Those loan words are to be found in Yorkshire and Northumbria as well. What makes the Scots language unique is its roots in Scottish Gaelic combined with those other influences. Robert Burns was born in Ayrshire in 1759, the same year in which the last speaker of Ayrshire or Galloway Gaelic died. His family had moved not long before from the northeast at a time when Gaelic was still the first language in places such as Upper Deeside and Glengairn. The cadences and metres of Burns could readily translate from Scots to Gaelic, precisely because Gaelic had helped shape those rhythms and metres in the first place. And Rory MacDonald was proud to make the connections among Scotland's three tongues because he believed that those connections strengthened them all. If he were still with us, and I am certain that he would want to join us in celebrating those things today. Thank you very much.
Afore I gang any further, I'm minded to accept a motion under Rule 8.14.3 that the debate be extended by 30 minutes due to the amount of speakers that we still have. Ms Harper, would you move that motion?
To extend another 30 minutes.
Is everyone agreed? Tap a leaf. I've used your three languages, Mr MacDonald. Right. Ruth Maguire, please, to be followed by Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I congratulate my colleague Emma Harper on securing this debate, marking the importance of both our national bard, Robbie Burns, and one of our national languages, Scots. Now, many towns lay claim to the bard, but there can be no doubt that it's the town of Irvine, in my own constituency, that has the strongest claim of all. Indeed, without Irvine, there might not even have been a world-famous poet called Robert Burns for us to talk about today. For it was in the then bustling harbour of Irvine, where Burns arrived in 1781 as a young 22-year-old, that he became friends with a local sea captain, Richard Brown, who encouraged him to become a poet. This is attested to Burns' own hand, who later wrote to Brown, reminding him of a Sunday they'd spent in Eglinton Woods, where Brown, upon hearing Burns recite some of his verses, had expressed his wonder that Burns could, and I quote, resist the temptation of sending verses of such merit to a magazine. It was this moment, in Burns' own words, that he decided to endeavour at the character of a poet. So Alloway may have made the man, but it was Irvine that made the poet. And it seems fitting that Irvine is home to what one national paper deemed to be the A-list Irvine Burns Club, the A-list Burns Club, I should say. I'm particularly proud to draw the Chamber's attention to the Irvine Burns Club, which has an unbroken history of nearly 200 years since it was first established in 1826, and will this year celebrate its 191st anniversary. The first president of the club, Dr. John Mackenzie, attended Robert Burns' father in his last illness, and the first vice president was David Siller, a friend of Burns from his early 20s. The highlight of the club's calendar is, of course, the annual Burns Night celebration, which I'm hugely looking forward to attending. However, as great a poet as Burns was, and as braw as Burns' suppers are, it's important to remember that Scots should not only be for Burns Night, that we still have much to do to overcome the paradox that the Scots language we celebrate and encourage on one day of the year remains all too often misunderstood and even discouraged and disparaged at the rest of the time. As someone with a bit of Gaelic, I'm only too familiar with the hostility that can be faced from some quarters when it comes to Scotland's minority languages. But one thing Gaelic is never accused of is of being a dialect or, worse, a corruption of English. With Scots, on the other hand, and despite great and ongoing efforts to raise awareness of the status and the history, these misperceptions are still all too common. And overcoming them remains perhaps the biggest issue for those of us who want to see the language respected and promoted. As such, whilst I welcome today's debate and look forward to joining my friends at Word Power's Radical Burns Night tonight and then Irvine Burns Club later in the week, I do hope that this Parliament will take opportunities in the future to delve deeper into the issues around Scots and to continue to build on the progress that's already been made in normalising, legitimising and promoting the language in all settings, written and spoken.
Apologies for calling in the wrong order earlier. Stuart Stevenson, please, followed by Oliver Mundell.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and many thanks to Emma Harper for the opportunity to talk about Burns. I've used this opportunity to extend the world of people who are familiar with Burns to one additional person, and that is my new American intern, Melia Daly, who's sitting in the public gallery, who's written my speech for me tonight. I stand with you today to celebrate the enduring legacy of the great poet Robert Burns and, of course, the Scots language. It's central, I believe, to understand what is meant by the word legacy. Legacy implies something of great significance in the past that continues to affect our present. It's a history ever present and impactful, a perfect description of Scots and the Bard. Now, the Scots language has had a turbulent history. It went through periods of discrimination when it was not to be spoken in good company, to times when it was a champion of the Scots people. We have championed the language in large part thanks to Robert Burns, whose memory we celebrate today. It was a language that divided society at parts of its history, but that's partly why it makes such an impact on our legacy today. It shows us the diversity of our history. But it was something that now is a jewel of our culture, where once it was very different. We remember the man who wrote the great literary works in Scots and helped secure the Scots language importance in the definition of Scotland. Burns was, without doubt, a literary genius. You have to read very few of his works to see why that's so. He also, of course, was a man with a reputation for womanising, and entirely justifiably. We rarely talk about one particular woman in his life, and of course, that was his wife, Jean Armour. She was the silent, strong supporter of the poet. I suspect being a poet's wife under any circumstances then or now, not terribly easy. Loyal wife, not one coming forward, but she was always there when Burns needed and loved her. He was arranging Scots into iconic poems. She was making sure that the basics of his life were looked after. She was working to make life better, not just for her, but for her significant family. I'm not sure what role she played in the family beyond those which were hers, of course. Her legacy is alive in Scotland, right alongside that of Burns. So we should think of her as we think of Burns. We work diligently and proudly to celebrate Robert Burns' life. I'm not here to preach on that. I perhaps came to Burns quite late in my life. But I think people right across Scotland understand who Burns is and what he's contributed to Scottish life. People on farms, on ships and cities all know of Burns. They are all part of the community that has inherited the legacy of Burns. The language and the words of Burns live today as they lived when he wrote them. It's a strengthening of the ties that bind us together. We overcome and rise above difficulties by looking at some of the things that Burns write. And we find simple enjoyment in the words of Burns. When we hear Holy Willie's Prayer, when we hear Tam O'Shanter, the narrative simply engages us. So it's part of what makes us a Scot, but it's also part of what we contribute to the world community. As Burns said of Jean, to see her was to love her. The legacy of Burns and Scots is that we recognise his words are more than simply words. Their legacy is us.
Oliver Mundell, to be followed by Gillian Martin.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. It's always, I find, quite intimidating to stand up and speak about Robert Burns, particularly when you've only got 4 minutes, because my first memory really of a Burns supper was in Moffat, where it opened with a joke that said that any speech on Burns should last exactly as long as it takes a married man to make love to his wife. And at the time, I had no idea what that meant, I've been told to sit down. I'll continue because this debate is really, really important, and I am very grateful to Emma Harper for bringing this forward. Again, I know it's a subject that she's very passionate about and has a long-standing history with in the community. And when I was in Dumfries today at the memorial service to commemorate Burns' life at St. Michael's Church in Dumfries, there were many people who were very, very excited to know that this debate was taking place tonight, because Burns is really at the heart of Dumfries, at the heart of my Dumfriesshire constituency. And without getting too controversial for what is a members' debate. I would take slight issue with this claim from those in Ayrshire that he properly belongs to them, because whilst he might have been born there, we've still got him, and is very, very important to Dumfries. And you know, you can't go around my constituency without finding Burns heritage, without meeting people who are there to explore his legacy and history, whether it's in Dumfries itself or further afield. I mean, he's visited practically every pub that's still open and still ongoing, and generally had a rather good time, with the notable exception, of course, of Echo Fechin, where he managed to get stuck of an evening. And he described the village as a wicked and evil little place. And it had absolutely nothing to do with the residents or the quality or quantity of the drink. It was purely because there was a lady singing in the establishment on the evening in question. And Burns felt that listening to her was like the sound of the sow meeting the butcher's knife, and that he couldn't decide whether the answer was to get drunk or, as I say, to hang himself. But luckily, he chose the drink. But you know, you only have to go to my own hometown of Moffat again to see his connection with local drinking establishments, because it was there that he wrote in the window, ask why God made the gem so small and why so large the granite, because God meant mankind should place a higher value on it. And you just, you know, you cannot escape his enduring legacy or the power of his works. And I wanted to very briefly read out a section of his epistle to Davy, a brother poet. It's no in title, nor in rank, it's no in wealth, like London Bank, to purchase peace and rest. It's no in making muckle mair, it's no in books, it's no in Lear, to make us truly blessed. If happiness hae not our seat and centre in the breast, we may be wise or rich or great, but never can be blessed. Nae treasures nor pleasures could make us happy lang, the heart's eyes, the part eye, that makes us ripped or rang. And I think that's it. Burns and Scots are in our heart. He wrote of Wallace that no Scot couldn't be moved by the tale of William Wallace. But I think now, as we look at his legacy, there's no Scot who cannot be moved by the influence he's had on our nation. So thank you.
I call Gillian Martin to be followed by Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm proud that our Parliament recognises the richness of the various Scots tongues, and they, just in debates specifically about our mother tongue. Even in this parliamentary session, if you look through our official report of this place, you'll find numerous Scots words peppered in our members' speeches, not least from my friend, Emma Harper, with whom I shared a challenge to sneak in the ord wee Boodich or Crater or Halley Racket in our speeches. And who knows, I might even get away with a bahookie or a bism one day if it doesn't skin her, the presiding officer, or should I say the heed bummer. My thanks going to Yon Afa Fine Quine, Emma Harper, for this debate, not least because I can catch up with her in the amount of wordies on the record. In schools last week, all the bairns would have been learning their Burns, and it reminds me of my own school days when it was the only time of year we could speak Scots or Doric in the classroom with any legitimacy. It's changed days. Last week I was in Meikle Mill School in Ellen, and they have Scots and Doric all over the place, and it's nae just for Burns Night. Being the hill place, there are Doric words over the was, and all the Wains were encouraged to tell stories of their own tongue. We're celebrating the life of the bard today, and Burns' father was, of course, from the northeast, changing his name from Burness to Burns as he headed down to Ayrshire. The northeast is a very strong Scots and Doric language tradition, and we all like to think that Burns was influenced by his father's history. Talking of Burns is as good as an excuse as any to shine a light on other champions of the mother tongue, some that might not be so well known as our bard, like Jean and Lucy Stewart from Fetid Angus, or Fishy as it's known. Their renditions of traditional Scots songs and ballads helped fuel a renaissance of interest in Scottish music that began in the 1960s. Lucy's collected and recorded work was an influence to Bob Dylan. In 1962, Bob Dylan modelled his song A Hard Rain's Gonna Fall on Lord Randall, which Lucy's work had introduced him to. And the Stuart family tradition goes on with Elizabeth Stuart, who's widely known as a traditional Doric folk singer and storyteller in her own right, and who I'm proud to say is a constituent of mine. And then there's Stanley Robertson, like the Stuart Quines, for a travelling family. Stanley was a poet and storyteller who had the great privilege of working with, before his death, on a range of Doric materials for a literacy programme for Aberdeen schools. The oral tradition of travelling folk in the northeast was embodied by this man, whose mind was chock full of old stories from generations of travelling folk that I am glad to say have been collected in the Elphinstone Kist at Aberdeen University. And the Elphinstone Kist is a rich collection of the sayings, stories and rhymes of the northeast that leads me on to the keeper of the Kist, the unofficial northeast bard, Sheena Blackhall. Bairns are learning Burns to a Moose right now, but I bet you they can recite Sheena's poem Hoolet without giving it a second thought. Celebrating Burns every year reminds us of the richness of the mother tongue, but with folk like Sheena, and I believe Matthew Fitt, who's in the gallery, scriving an awa in a national in our mother tongue every week, our macker, Jackie Kay, and Derek McClure, who Lewis mentioned, the author of one of my favourite books, Why Scots Matters. And the good work of the Wains and the teachers, Scots and Doric is alive and well. And it's nae just for the 25th of January, but for a' the days of the year. Thank you.
I call Fulton McGregor to be followed by Finlay Carson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thanks to Emma Harper for giving me and everybody else the opportunity to talk in this debate. Now, it is fair to say that I'm a wee bit of a Burns fan, and I see Emma's got the book there, and I've also got the complete collection book, and I've got it in CD format as well, and it's quite a number of CDs, I have to say, but I would highly recommend it to anybody that wanted to listen to it, and it's a whole load of different singers from across Scotland. Some of you may be familiar with it. And I think that going to the motion itself, I think that it is fair to say that Burns still influences people here in Scotland and across the world. And I was very, very heartened today to see schools across my constituency, as I'm sure it was for everybody here, their Twitter feed's been very active today, and all the kids engaging in the various Burns activities. And I've got a few examples. For example, at Townhead Primary School, there was a poetry competition, and the delighted winners were showing their prizes. At Kirkshaw's Primary School, they were tweeting about watching the Highland Games, and they had dressed up, and it was good to see the pictures showing an engrossed audience. And at St Stephen's Primary School, they tweeted that they were learning about the Scots dialect and that they had taken the time to write their own poem as such, and I thought that was very, very fitting and in line with tonight's debate. And I think that it is good that, you know, the kids are today across the constituency and across Scotland are getting to learn about our heritage and the Scots dialect. And when I was growing up, we'd done Burns every year, like probably most people in school. But and I think there's regional variations in accents and words that we use. And I didn't actually realise that a lot of the words that I was using until I went to university and actually went out the confines of Coatbridge in wider Lanarkshire, that people would say to me, why do you speak so slang and stuff like that? So I didn't actually realise that a lot of those words that were still, you know, integrated into my speech at various points were actually Scots language. And when I did find that out as a sort of teenager into my 20s, I was absolutely delighted. For me, in terms of Burns' work, I obviously like the classics, A Man's a Man and Banks and Braes, amongst many others, but I also like some of the more lesser known ones, For the Airts and the ballad that is The Lament of Mary, Queen of Scots, which I think is an absolutely fantastic poem. And two of my favourites are Parcel of Rogues and a Nation and the absolutely brilliant Caledonia. Parcel of Rogues and a Nation, I think, is a very political, message that he gives at that time, and you know, to think that somebody was writing and sort of the messages that he was getting across at that point in time, I think it's absolutely fascinating to think how many years ago that it was. I would like to say that I had intended to go to the full dinner tonight at the presiding officer's Burns event, but I've also promised my wee boy to eat some haggis with him. He's just coming up for three, so I hope to everybody that is going that it's a good night, and I've already now put in my apologies. And I'd like to just finish with the final paragraph from my favourite song that I mentioned earlier. Pips is my favourite. It's called Caledonia. And the final paragraph is, "Thus bold, independent, unconquered and free, her bright course of glory forever shall run. For brave Caledonia, immortal must be. I'll prove it from Euclid as clear as the sun. Rectangle, triangle, the figure we'll choose. The upright is chance and old time is the base. But brave Caledonia is the hypotenuse. Then ergo she'll match them and match them always." Thanks.
I call Finlay Carson to be followed by Marie Todd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's a real privilege to take part in this debate, and I thank Emma for securing it. It's such a shame that we've been conditioned out of speaking Scots, because when I'm at home, I very quickly revert to my playground chat with my dad, and we talk about the weather and what we're going to do, and I very quickly go into it, particularly if you had a wee rusty nail. And it's a shame that we have to put in an effort actually not to use Scots when we're in the debating chamber. But from a personal perspective, the 25th of January has always been a really important date for myself and my family. There's every likelihood that my great-great-great-great-great-grandfather was Burns's blacksmith, because he lived at Hollywood just at the time that Burns farmed at Ellisland. But my family are all Burns enthusiasts. My daughter Vicky and son Hugh regularly sing, recite or play Burns' works. But tonight there's no point me giving you a history of Robert Burns, because I'm quite sure you'll know it just as well, if not better than me. But what is worthy of reflection is to recall the state of the world in which Burns was born into and which he grew up in. Only 13 years had passed since the Battle of Culloden, which was the last battle fought on British soil, one in which Scots, let's not forget, participated on both sides. And when Burns was only 17, came news of the American Declaration of Independence, and by the time he was 30, we had the French Revolution. All through his life, there were conflicts, and wherever you live in those times, you live with a certain amount of fear, suspicion, danger, and challenge. And of course, much of those uncertainties and challenges were also reflected in the thinking and writing of the time. You know, with all this turmoil, you can only have influenced the mind of young Robert as he sought to answer the questions which must have poured out of his fertile imagination. Many of those questions must, of course, have been political, and I'm always fascinated in the fact that most shades of political spectrum will claim that Robert Burns was one of his own. The socialist and our Labour colleagues have left, would look to a man's a man, for ah that, it's coming yet, for ah that man to man the world our shall brothers be, for ah that. And the nationalists could choose Burns's address at Bannockburn, more commonly known as Scotswahay, which was written just about 3-4 miles away from where I live at the moment, in Gatehouse of Fleet. Scots where Wallace bled, Scots when Bruce is often led, welcome to your gory bed, or to victory. Wha for Scotland's king and law, freedom saw will strongly draw, freedom stand or freeman fall, let him follow me. And us unionists, and amazingly I believe even some UKIPers, claim him as their own from the address to the Dumfries Volunteers. Oh, let us not, like snarling curs and wrangling, be divided, till slap come in on Umkaloon and we a wrong decide it. Be Britain still to Britain true, among ourselves united, for never but by British hands mon British wrongs be righted. So he cleverly spanned all shades of politics, and as a novice politician, I can only admire the dexterity and ease with which he did so. Given the tumult of the day, he could easily have written with bitterness, envy, greed, or jealousy, but what emerges from his work is a picture of a man of understanding, of honesty, of justice, and of extraordinary emotion and compassion for his fellow man. As Oliver's already said, he penned his epistle to Davy when he was only 25. It's not in title nor ranks, it's not in wealth and London banks, to purchase peace and rest. It's not in making muckle mair, it's not in books, it's not in lair. to make us truly blessed. If happiness has not her seat and centre of the breast, we may be wise or rich or great, but never can be blessed. Nae treasures, nae pleasures can make us happy lang. The heart's eye, the part eye, that makes us right or wrong. Burns also had a healthy scepticism of the authorities, whether it took the shape of the local landlord, the local church, the presbytery, or parliament. And he made it quite clear in Holy's Willie prayer when he wrote, Lord, hear my earnest cry in prayer against that presbytery I hear. Thy strong right hand, Lord, make it bear upon their heads. Lord, visit them and dinna spare for their misdeeds. I'm sure that scepticism would be alive and well today, presiding officer. But what I'm certain of is that he would have been enormously proud of the moment that will live with me and many other MSPs forever. It's how he would have been filled with pride at the opening of Holyrood in both 1999, when Sheena Wellington, and more recently when Midgeur in 2016 sang the wonderful anthem. The let us pray that come it may, as come it will for a' that, that sense and worth o'er a' the earth shall bear the grief and a' that. For a' that and a' that, it's coming yet for a' that, that man to man the world hour shall brothers be for a' that. Presiding officer, there can surely be no better vision for any politician, no matter his creed or political colour, than that.
I call Marie Todd to be followed by John McAlpine.
Thank you, presiding officer, and thank you too to Emma Harper for securing this debate. For all that I love the poetry of Robert Burns, what pleases me most is that down these two centuries and more since he died, our country has chosen his birthday to think on a poet and poetry. I don't mind whether it's his radical sentiments, his observations on a fast disappearing agrarian way of life, body verses, or the peerless tale of Tam O'Shanter. We cheer our most famous poet, recite and enjoy his verses and songs, and do so in a singular style. I don't suppose it's unique, but it is perhaps unusual that a country should for a day each year take its collective breath and turn its thoughts to poetry in this way. And it makes me just a little proud, because poetry matters. Since our Parliament has reconvened, we've blessed ourselves with marvellous makers, cementing poetry in our consciousness and our civic life. None of us who watched it, or who might have had the privilege of being present when the Scottish Parliament reconvened, will forget Sheena Wellington singing A Man's a Man and just how a nation responded on that day. But the occasion was also illuminated by Amy Lineker, a schoolgirl from Thurso, with her poem How to Create a Great Country, which contained a thistle's worth of spike. Just this month, our latest macker, Jackie Kay, caused a bit of a stooshy with her poem about the love that parents feel for their newborn babies. I loved it. My daughter, Rachel, shares a birthday with Robert Burns, and I hope you'll indulge me as I take the opportunity to wish her a happy birthday. Yeah. Let your life, hey luck, health, charm, you are my bonny blessed bairn. When Jackie Kay took her post, she said, as Robert Burns demonstrated, poetry holds up a unique mirror to a nation's heart, mind, and soul. It's the pure language that tells us who we are. Holding that mirror to a nation's heart, mind, and soul can be dangerous. Even a poet as sensational as Robert Burns, a rock star in his day, had to watch his step. Writers and songsmiths across the world endure persecution. We live in a world where some governments or rulers can be so alarmed at thoughts written, spoken, or sung that they'll suppress them cruelly. In these dangerous times and worrying times, we need our poets more than ever. Poetry, whether in its highest expression or the rhymes of the playground, has the capacity to be fun, to make us laugh, to make us cry, to bring the best of us to the fore. Poetry can do that. Are we a nation of poets? Perhaps it's not a bad aspiration. But although we may believe poetry to be in the mist and our hills or in the closest unwinds of our boroughs and cities, embedded in our souls or in our DNA, such a belief, such an aspiration cannot be fulfilled by chance. It must be nurtured and protected. Space and time, understanding and our love given to all of our languages and all of our means of expression. So Robert Burns, today, in a chamber full of honest men and bonny lasses, and hopefully some bonny men and honest lasses too, I toast not just your memory, but all the poets, past, present and future, of our multiform, our infinite Scotland.
Do you know, I'm starting to feel quite emotional. I call John McAlpin to be followed by the last of our open speakers, who will be Claire Adamson.
Thank you. I want to congratulate my friend Emma Harper on securing this debate. Normally we see muckle flighting here. The day on the Bard's birthday, we are all canty and agreed. Robbie Burns would be fair astonished and content to hear himself praised in your reconvened Scots Parliament. Sort it again, despite the actions of that parcel of rogues, he admonished Lang Syne. I'm nae Scots scholar, but I ween I speak Scots. Mony Scots, with a good Scots tongue in their mouth, have been tell they just haver in slang. Our Parliament can challenge those attitudes. In 2003, a cross-party group on the Scots lead was formed by Labour's Cathy Peattie and the SNP's Irene McGugan. The statement of principles for that group is worth repeating. Yin, Scots is a language. Twa, action maun be taen to put an end to all prejudice and discrimination against the Scots language. Thrie, the Scots language is integral and essential to cultural and personal identity in Scotland. Fower, a knowledge of Scots is vital to a knowledge of Scotland. Five, action maun be taen to gie the Scots language whatever means is needed to maximise its transmission and continuity. Six, Scots should be an essential part of the educational curriculum in Scotland at all levels. Seven, nobody should be penalised or put in doon for speaking Scots. Eight, Scots' proper names and place names should be valued and safeguarded. The own principles were scrived more than a decade syne. Have they been achieved? I hae my doubts. There's mair work to be done. I hope all the MSPs who spoke sae well the day will consider supporting another cross-party group on the Scots lead and play our part in helping it to thrive all year. The statement of principles of that group quoted Ian Crichton-Smith, another poet who wrote in Gaelic, another tongue. He that loses his language loses the world. Let that our lesson be.
I call Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and thank you, Emma Harper, for securing this wonderful debate this afternoon. So many heroes of the Scots language have already been mentioned today, in particular Billy Kay, whose book The Mother Tongue gave me permission to love my language, and I'm very grateful to him for that. To Matthew Fitt, a very grateful thanks for the wonderful memories I have with my now 19-year-old son reading your books in Scots language and being able to share those, especially with my English nieces. Wonderful memories and wonderful experiences of our language. One person who hasn't been mentioned, and as she comes from Motherwell, it would be very amiss of me not to mention Liz Lochlead. Someone who has been a wonderful macker for Scotland and inspired so many of her. And I'd just like to quote from her poem, Bairnsang. It was January, a gaidreik day, the first day I went to the school. So my mum happed me up in my good navy blue nap coat with a red tartan hood, birled a scarf around my neck, poured on my pixie and my pockies. It was that bitter. Said, "Noo, you'll no starve." Gave me a wee kiss and a kid on scalp on the bum and sent me across the playground to the place where I'd learned to say it was January. A really dismal day, the first day I went to school. So my mother wrapped me up in my best navy blue topcoat with the red tartan hood, twirled a scarf around my neck, pulled on my bobble hat and mittens. It was so bitterly cold. Said, "Now you won't freeze to death." Gave me a little kiss and a pretend slap on the bottom to the place where I'd learned to forget to say it was January and a gaidreik day, the first day I went to school. A short extract from Bairnsang, which to me is a lesson for every child in Scotland,
about their language, about the warmth, the nature, the feeling of the language that's their own, and how they should never be made to feel as if that language does not belong to them. But today is all about Burns. And Burns has many characters, and some of his indiscretions and the negative side of him have been mentioned today. And although he's often considered not to be a friend to women, there are two poems in particular of Burns that mean a lot to me. Both are songs. I wouldn't sing them today to presiding officer, thankfully. But they're unusual in that they are both told from the point of view of a woman. The first one is an extract from The Rant and Dog, and it's about a young woman who finds herself pregnant, unmarried, and has all the concerns that might face someone today in that situation. Who'll buy the baby's clothes? Who'll pay the midwife at that time? Who'll claim the baby? So, what my bairnie clutes will buy? What will tent me when I cry? What will kiss me where I lie? The rant and dog, the daddy oat. Who will own he who did the fought? Who will buy the groaning mot? Who will tell me what to call it? The rant and dog, the daddy oat. And I think that shows a real understanding of the predicament of women from Burns. And the other one, Lewis MacDonald has had to leave, but the other poem that came to mind when I was listening to him today was The Highland Widow's Lament. It's a poem that Burns wrote, and one that meant so much to him on seeing a woman from the Highlands begging, someone who had been made destitute. And it's about the end of the war in Culloden, where she was made homeless. Their woeful tale, what need I tell? Right to their ang did yield. My Donald and his country fell upon Culloden's field. Oh, I'm come to the low country, O'Con, O'Con, O'Cree. Nae woman in this world wide, sae wretch now as me. Presiding officer, those are a few of my favourite bits of Burns, and I thank Emma once again for this wonderful opportunity to celebrate him this evening.
I call Alistair Allen to close this debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Many thanks to Emma Harper for bringing this debate to the floor of the Parliament the night, and to the Routh the Ithers, our money to name, it's back in the debate and all. Able is that, yeah, disappointment that there was a nicht was, with no offence intended, when Stuart Stevenson spoke, because many of us at this place are acquaint with Stuart Stevenson's tales of his family and his family history, and it was a sair disappointment to many of us to find out that Stuart Stevenson isn't come down for the great man himself. But let me start by reading one of the first reviews that Burns ever had anent his work. The Scots Magazine, of the 1st of December 1786. It tells us a fair lot about the things Burns and the Scots tongue has had to thole their hinnermost 200 year. And like Miss Harper, I come from the bit of Scotland that says twa instead of twa. The reviewer scrives in his bit of the Scots magazine, I know not if I shall be accused of enthusiasm and partiality when I introduce to the notice of my readers a poet of our own country. The person to whom I allude is Robert Burns, an Ayrshire ploughman. In mentioning the circumstance of his humble situation, I mean not to urge the merits of his poetry solely when considered in relation to the lowness of his birth and the little opportunity of improvement which his education could afford. These particulars indeed might excite our wonder at his productions, but his poetry, considered abstractly and without the apologies arising from his situation, seems to me fully entitled to command our feelings and to obtain our applause. Now, what Burns come for socially is airt and pair to what he is, but it has been used to sneer at him or to gar folk jaloos at his poetry and just be couthy or a stuff. The reviewer wrings his hands a wee bit mair and says, then there is the language in which most of his poems are written. In England, it cannot be read at all without such constant reference to a glossary as to nearly destroy that pleasure. Some of his productions, however, especially those of the grave style, are almost English. Ginnick an hour set down for the record, he is saying this. Burns winna mak ony salary to a' this, for the yeah literary scene at Mitters is in London. But he lose at Burns can, mair or less, scrive English for by, so he canna be a'thegither donard. With what uncommon penetration and sagacity has this heaven-taught ploughman from his humble and unlettered station looked upon men and manners? And say we hae the review of the Kilmarnock edition, it gins praising Burns and patronising him, and Guinness, I think, for the record, maybe is the first ever yes of the phrase heaven-taught ploughman. Presiding officer, though I represent the Gaelic-speaking bit of Scotland, I was brought up at the other end of the country altogether. Both my grandfathers was ploughmen, say Burns speaks to me. But Burns speaks to the whole world and all. And just as Mr. MacDonald mentioned about his father's work to translate Burns from Scots into Gaelic, just the other week a body scrive it to me to ask or to tell me about a new ettle to ourset Burns into Estonian. And already, as his other members has mentioned, Burns is being recited and sung the world out of the night. And as Mr. Scott rightly says, peer to the way that it is that we're celebrating him, is that he gave the Scots tongue an epic poem and the status that Dóin brought with. So the Scottish Government forders the recognition of Scots in all its forms. It is at the heart of our communities and our literature. A few years ago, I was a member of the government's Scots Language Ministerial Working Group, and since then, for the first time in 2011, there was a question on Scots of the census that showed 1.5 million Scots had some kenning of Scots. And we brought in Scots language coordinators of the skills, Scots lead policy, and many other things for by, and Creative Scotland and others has been supportive in all. And though some members grat for rage about it at the time, as an education minister, I brought in the requirement at the higher English exam spears a compulsory question on Scottish literature. But, presiding officer, let me give the hindmost word to Burns himself in their satirical words that he addressed to Scotland's representatives of the House of Commons. Of course, Burns didn't hear vote himself, but he had his own views, and among other things, he had views on the question of language. And he said, "Could he some commutation broach? I'll pledge my aith and good braid Scotch. He needna fear their foul reproach, nor erudition, yon mixty, maxty, queer, hotchpotch, the coalition. Old Scotland has a rockle tongue, she's just a devil wi' a rung, and if she promised all their young to tuck their pert, though by the neck she should be strung, she'll no desert. God bless your honours all your days wi' soups o' kale and brats o' clays, in spite o' a' the thievish kays that haunts St. Jamie's. Your humble poet sings and prays, while Rab his name is."
I forgot to put the microphone on. I close this meeting.